Do you feel unlucky in love because what you are experiencing right now in your marriage is the complete opposite of what you had dreamt of? Well, let me tell you, life in general is full of challenges. And the ones in marriage are called marital problems. And almost every couple has them. Even the happiest couple on earth do face challenges. And these challenges are very similar from one marriage to the other.
But over the years, couples learn to effectively navigate through these problems. Shantai and I started our journey 14 years ago, and we've had our own challenges, but God has been faithful to lead us through. And through it all, we've had principles that we've applied. We are here today to share those principles with you so that you can take them and apply in your own unique situation.
Yes, it's really about principles because the solutions to marital problems are hardly ever one size fits all. Because those problems may look similar, but the underlying factors may really differ from one relationship to the other. And so that's why even here on Shanti Bloom, I always tell you that I share applicable principles and simple practical steps that you can apply in your own unique situation. And then it will help you to move away from that place of feeling stuck over to where you can now bloom and flourish in your everyday. So without wasting time, let's dive into the part two of the common problems in marriage and how to overcome them.
Problem number one is competition. We live in a world today that encourages the spirit of me, myself, and I. It's no longer us. It seems as though when someone uses us, they seem weak.
Yeah.
Which is truly unfortunate. Embracing us in a marriage doesn't take away your individuality.
No, it shouldn't take away your individuality. You know, if you watch the part one of this video, we really emphasize on the importance of knowing who you are, finding your identity, finding your purpose in life. But knowing who you are and finding your purpose in life should not introduce competition in your marriage. It should rather build so much confidence within you that it drives away that spirit of insecurity, which is usually one of the main causes of competition in a relationship. You know, insecurities centered around maybe finances. You know, I bring in the least amount of money to the table.
Or even and, career, right?
Yes, career is another one.
And some people believe that their careers are less prestigious, and because of it, it encourages the spirit of competition.
You start begin to compete with your partner. You know, if you can identify the sources of insecurities in your relationship and deal with them accordingly, competition will leave you. Ask yourself, why do I feel so insecure around my spouse? Does it have to do with, you know, the way I was raised, my background, or does it have to do with certain expectations in my society or culture I'm feeling like I cannot measure up to? Does it, you know, have to do with maybe a past toxic relationship? Really try to find out what the source of that insecurity is and deal with it so that competition will leave your marriage, because competition really turns to affect trust too.
Oh yeah, it does.
You know, and trust is a very important pillar in a relationship.
Yes.
It affects trust because it's difficult to trust somebody who is competing with you, somebody who is like trying to put you down. You begin to see the person almost like an
enemy.
An enemy. You know, so it is very important to, you know, deal with competition in your relationship and don't allow it to start affecting, you know, the trust factor of your home.
When you begin to see your spouse as the enemy, it also leads to a fear, lack of transparency, lack of honesty, and also lack of vulnerability.
Yeah.
Because you can't be vulnerable with someone you don't trust.
You don't trust.
And like we discussed in our last video, when all of this is present in a relationship, it leads to emotional disconnection.
Yeah, you disconnect emotionally.
And you know what? That also leads to physical disconnection. And then suddenly you realize that you aren't intimate with each other.
Yeah, because you know, intimacy has a lot to do with that emotional connection. So if you're disconnected emotionally, finally you disconnect physically, it affects, you know, intimacy, because it also needs a lot of expression, freedom of expression. And if there's that, all of that is absent, you know, you soon find yourself like two couples, you know, two strangers living within the same home. And that is why competition is very, very dangerous. It is like this thing that leads to one thing and then to another thing and then to another thing. And even it also affects communication eventually. Eventually you cannot really communicate, and you know that, you know, there is no way that a relationship can bloom and flourish without, you know, effective communication. Sometimes this competition spills outside the home, right? You've left from competing with one another or competing with your spouse. Now you want to compete with friends and with family out there. And it's really dangerous. I've seen places where, you know, people who were heading down a certain path, they're making their plans on how they want to, the things they want to do, where they want to go. And suddenly, because you are now competing with somebody or with a group of people, you are now changing your plans. You know, what you do or not do now is determined by that spirit of competition. That can really take you off track. The Bible says that can two walk together unless they agree. There's need for a lot of agreement, teamwork in a marriage for that home to function properly. Because over time you will grow, new things will come into your life, you'll find yourself in new seasons, some good seasons, some challenging seasons, and there's that need for teamwork. There's that need to help one another coordinate things together for the smooth functioning of that home.
Like for us, over the years we've grown in our careers, the kids came in, and so many things happened, and the only way we were able to be successful in this is that we had to have a lot of teamwork. We had to help each other in all of our endeavors.
And I can say that God has really helped us in this, you know, when it comes to competition. We can humbly say that we have been supportive of each other over the years instead of competing with one another, and we have grown in that support. You know, the way we support each other now is much more than we did, you know, at the beginning of our marriage. But one truth is that we've always meant well, you know, for one another when you were growing and you had something ahead of you. I'll be excited about it, pray about it, and look forward to it. And the same thing with me. And when things became tough and we needed to make some adjustments, we sat together as a team and we made those agreements. You know, there are times when I've left from working mom to stay at home mom, back to working mom, you know, because we needed to coordinate, and you know, we made our own decision on how it will work for our home. And again, that's why we said competing with people outside your home is very dangerous, because there are certain decisions we took that we would not have taken those decisions had we have, so you know, if we were competing with people out of the home. We we focused, you know, we paid attention to our own journey, where we were going, heading to, why we took certain decisions the way we took them. You know, even when we made where we thought there were mistakes, we corrected them, and we just kept going. So competition is a very dangerous thing in your home. Over the years we have grown. When you grow, you complete one another. You don't compete with one another. The next is financial conflicts. A lot of financial conflicts come from the differences in spending habits. And even when the couple both have, you know, similar spending habits, they will still have money arguments, you know. Like for both of us, we do come from similar middle class families, and you know, the way we dealt with money is very similar, but we still had arguments about money. And at times it's even personalities also come in place. Like you tend to be someone who is a little bit more spontaneous, and I can tend to overplan and analyze things. And over the years we have seen where the strengths and weaknesses of these different personalities can come in when it comes to money.
But the solution begins with being transparent with each other about your income, about the money plans and any debts you have, which is very important. A lot of people are not transparent with their spouses when it comes to money, and this is clearly an issue. Without transparency, you won't be able to know your present financial situation. Let me ask you a question. Do you know what you're worth? Have you ever taken time to look at your income versus your expenditure? Do you know what the picture looks like?
You know, talking about the picture, we would also like to encourage you that if you look at the picture and it doesn't look good, you know, do not be afraid. Do not allow fear to come in. Do not be anxious, and do not even be envious of those who have already figured it out. What you should do is keep a cool head and try to figure out an action plan, you know, a plan of action as a couple. How are we going to get out of this, you know, situation or this debt or how things are looking at the moment? And then you go from there. Remember, this journey is between you and your spouse. You know, I still remember when we had looked at our financial situation, we had some projects ahead of us. We knew that if we did not make certain changes, you know, we'll not be able to accomplish those things in our lives. And when we made those changes, we did not think about what others thought or what they would say. We had to cut down on some things in our lives, and we headed down our path. That's why, like we said earlier, competition between you two or with people outside, it's not healthy. Yeah, because in moments like this, you cannot make plans to get out of your debt because you'll be busy trying to impress people.
Exactly.
But we decided to, you know, look at our unique situation and make our plan of action. And again, you can never say that you know it all. You know, exactly. You have to seek help.
We got her for our action plan from Dave Ramsey, who was introduced to us by our pastor.
And we
learned a lot from Dave Ramsey. Some of the key things which I think we learned was creating budget categories by giving each dollar
a name and a destination.
Oh, definitely, because that's very key and important. We also learned about
using actual money.
Yeah, using actual money. Oh, yeah, that's a big one to stay away from.
All the credit card debt.
Yeah,
that was, I think another big one was
we had to cut some of these, you know, the cards. Yes.
Yes. And I think also another big one was creating separate budgets for personal expenditure.
Yeah.
You know, to avoid arguments over maybe very personal,
that's
expenses.
Yes.
So again, there were so many other things that, you know, the program comes with. But again, people have different preferences when it comes to financial advice and how they want to go about things.
Yeah.
And so I don't think that there is just a one way to do it.
Exactly.
All we are saying here is that as long as that plan involves transparency,
exactly.
mutual
transparency,
respect,
yeah.
you know, good intention for one another,
yes.
and also involves you giving outside your home, outside just both of you. How
exactly.
are you people giving together outside there?
Exactly.
As long as that plan has those important components, I think you should go ahead with it. The important thing is that have an action plan.
Even after having an action plan, it is important to constantly and consistently talk with your spouse about your finances. When did you last sit down and respectfully and transparently talk with your spouse about your finances?
The last thing we'll address here is friends and family.
Yeah.
You know, just dealing with the complexity of your own self is challenging.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get married and your spouse is coming with their own complexity.
Yeah.
You know, the challenges increase.
Yeah.
And then it's not like your spouse is coming alone, right? They are coming with their
friends
and family. And so the challenges can,
it takes to a
you know,
different level.
Go to another.
But please do not let these challenges get to the point of breaking your marriage.
No, it shouldn't come to the point of breaking. I think often it comes to that place of breaking your marriage when people take it to two extremes. The first extreme is when a spouse forgets that the other partner did not fall from the sky, right? They came from a family, a community, and just because they are forming a new relationship doesn't mean that they will suddenly just cut off from old ones. You know, this kind of atmosphere, if you create this type of atmosphere in your relationship, it will definitely bring problems.
Yeah,
and I think that is even why some people are so afraid to commit, because they feel like, oh my goodness, marriage is going to feel like a prison for me.
Yeah.
I will not have the freedom to have the friends that I want to have or with my family or do the things that I want to do.
The other extreme is when one spouse forgets that there are moments when three is a crowd. When you get married, your status has changed. And there are certain things that are bound to change.
Yeah.
There are certain things you used to do with friends and families that will probably have to change. For example, maybe the frequency in which you used to go out with them might have to change because now you have responsibilities. And it is not for them to know this, but for you who is experiencing
that
this change to let them know.
So if you're experiencing these two extremes in your relationship, then you have to sit down and have an honest communication or conversation, right? Tell your partner, hey, I feel like you're cutting me off every other relationship or friendship that I've ever had, you know, unless there is really a need for it, you know, because there are circumstances that, you know, there's a need for that. And the other person can also, you know, clearly say that, hey, I feel like we really are not maintaining healthy boundaries in our relationship. And I think that when both of you have this honest conversation, you are able to go from there, you know, walking that, you know, your way out or walking your way through that problem. But I would also say that keep in mind that there are some people out there who are generally difficult people, yeah. You know, friends, families, and you cannot expect or punish your partner for the behavior of others, right? And I think that is when we have to remind ourselves that we have been called to a higher standard of love, mm-hmm. where we have to accommodate other people, we have to be more understanding, mm-hmm. keeping in mind that we also have received mercy and grace. Mm-hmm. Somebody somewhere is also accommodating a weakness of yours, and so when you keep that in mind, that some you are receiving mercy and grace from others, you'll be able to show mercy, grace, tolerance towards, you know, other people who are in your life. We have been called to live in a community, and we have to just learn to deal with each other's differences. And again, we're saying in a healthy manner. Yes. We're not saying that, you know, it should be to a point where you are choking, you know, somebody is abusing you and you are taking it. No, you address it, but you address it with love.
This brings us to the conclusion that selfless love is needed for a healthy marriage.
Mm-hmm.
But as we know, that is not an easy proposition.
No.
And this is exactly why we need God to help us in this matter.
We really need God's help. Yes, you know, I've said it many times on this channel that if you're going to do life God's way, you are going to need His help, because He has called us to a higher standard of love. And the Bible clearly tells us that unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Yes. Unless the Lord comes and builds your broken marriage or builds, you know, the problems that you have in your marriage, we will be laboring in vain trying to apply all these tips that we are sharing here. So do not only invite Him into your home, but make Him Lord over your lives. Because the moment you as individuals learn to love and submit to God, it helps you to become more selfless, you know, and love each other from that selfless place. And I think that, you know, it comes with spiritual growth. That's why I've been growing spiritually. It is helping us to become a little bit more meek, a little bit more selfless as we deal with one another. And again, this will need a lot of determination. It's not just going to come like that. You have to hold each other accountable spiritually, you know, in prayers, in how you're growing spiritually. Because as you grow spiritually, trust me, it really helps your relationship. So be at peace. Bring those problems before the Lord. He is willing to help you, you know, walk through those things as a couple, and before you know it, you come out on the other side victorious. Now, the list of problems in marriage are so many, but we just thought to highlight these few, and I hope that you found it helpful. If you did, then give the video a thumbs up and share it so that others can also benefit from it. And please consider subscribing if you haven't done so. Keep that notification bell on so that you'll be notified when the next video comes up. Thank you all so much for watching, and see you in the next.